So again, it is my profound pleasure to introduce to you some very important artists and art historians and writers: Barbara Chase Riboud, Charles Gaines, Paul Carter Harrison, and Carrie Mae Weems in conversation. They will come to you first separately in their presentations, and then they will have a they will sit down together and have a discussion that will be moderated by Rick Powell. So let's please welcome, I believe, Barbara Chase Riboud is our Paul Carter Harrison. Let's welcome Paul Carter Harrison to the stage. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. I have the unenviable task of playing in the dark, to borrow Toni Morrison's reference, to be able to excavate some space for the illumination that will follow me this morning. So I'm happy to be in the company of this highly esteemed collection of artists. How did I get here? This particular trajectory that I've been on for the last 50 years was designed always to disrupt the tyranny of the Western aesthetic on the cultural production of African Americans. I mean, 50 years. And it is starting to have some traction only after 50 years. That's amazing. So I think of this question of aesthetics, black aesthetics. I made the sort of inappropriate response to the question recently in Atlanta. A group was assembled to discuss black aesthetics, and a gentleman asked me, well, what actually is black aesthetics? I said, well, aesthetic is the opposite of anesthetic. That's what turns you on, as opposed to turning you off. Well, that was totally inappropriate. Well, I realized that at a certain moment, and I scratched my head and I said, okay, I'm sorry, forgive me for that little sort of, you know, little quirk in my response there. And I gave him another response, which I'm going to share with you. I said, that which is defined in the aesthetic of the Western canon is actually equivalent in the black world to the organizing principle of an aphrologically constructed creative process. Independent of direct influence from African continent, that reflects the mythology, iconography, and the critique of the diverse cultures throughout the African diaspora. We're getting closer now. It is my assumption that close inspection of the diaspora will reveal many commonalities in the organizing principles that give birth to creative expression, which can thus represent an Afro-focal, if not otherwise, a black response to the universe. And I say that Afro-focal only because in recent times, in the last 40 years, in the initial thrust toward this disruption with the black arts movement, it suddenly has been vitiated to mean something racial. And no one is looking past, let's put it this way, folks have not been looking past the race when talking about the work or the cultural production that's being produced by African Americans or African Caribbeans, Africans in Brazil, throughout the world. And so I'm trying to figure out, do we even need the term aesthetic, which both aesthetic was a term that was a kind of a fabrication too. It was something from the Enlightenment to give a kind of a quality distinction between that which was an artifact prior to even the Greeks and beyond the Greeks. It was known that a person who was a tailor was an artist. And then suddenly, by the time you get to the 18th century or 17th century, that artist, it's no longer the artist. The artist is the person who has a refined kind of reflection, who produces a kind of a sensory response that people can call art, a higher form. And it's interesting that in most African languages, there's no such thing as a word called aesthetics or otherwise even art. It is merely the production of work that has the empowerment possibilities through spirit that is revealed in that piece of work that is being done. And that's what I have come to in these many years. What is beauty? Beauty is power. What is power? The luminosity of the spirit. That's what's beautiful. Not the pretty picture. Not the very nicely tailored suit. It is beautiful because it is potent, that particular quality. And having said that, I wanted to read to you a little bit from a piece I have done, or I had done recently with, I don't know if you know this magazine, this journal, Black Renaissance Noir. It's putting a lot of words, a lot of things together, all in one breath. Black Renaissance Noir. The editor is, I think we all know him, Quincy Troop. And in this particular edition, I do a piece on called Rebranding Black Theater. I am of the theater. It's my important, it's my particular responsibility then to interrogate what is going on in the theater. So rebranding black theater, why do I have to rebrand it? Because black theater has become a kind of commercial enterprise, a kind of commodification, a kind of totally corrupt way of looking at black life. There's a narrative that goes on in the black theater, or in fact most of black art, quote unquote black art, which is based upon a preconceived narrative. And if you do not respond to that narrative, your work is seldom done. Then forces you into some kind of posture of being avant-garde, which is not what, what I'm talking about. So with that in mind, if you'll bear with me, I want to give you a sense of how I got here. First, we should acknowledge that ever since the 19th century, the Negro had a place in the American theater as both subject and performer, mostly limited to musicals, comedies, and domestic melodramas. It's the melodramas part that's also so, it's often for me very annoying, to see that continued in the 21st century. It would require, however, the social and cultural ferment of the 1960s before the black artists would reassert aesthetic priorities that could rescue the Negro from the American theater and expose black characterizations that projected a worldview consonant with black theater dramaturgical strategies for social change. Now, this is interesting to me. I can remember vividly arriving from Europe in 1968 to teach at Howard University in the midst of the new black cultural ferment that had captured the imagination of black intellectuals and artists who were resisting oppression and challenges to self-determination. My first teaching assignment was, quote, "The Negro in the American Theater: Exposition of the Black American Experience through a catalog of plays from the late 19th century through the 20th century seemed out of touch, even contradictory to the spirit of the newly imagined ideals of self-determination and the awakening of aesthetic alternatives to the post-Chekhovian American models of realism represented in the self-absorbed angst of Eugene O'Neill, often reputed to, who was often reputed to be the patriarch of modern American playwriting. With Miller, a social reformer who did have some appeal to, for the new black dramatist, the dramaturgical exposition of his popularist didacticism seemed somewhat constrained for the urgencies of black liberation. And the new ideals seemed incompatible with the pessimism revealed in Tennessee Williams's excavation of the dark side of human experience." So these plays were something of a nuisance factor for me. I could not, I mean, I started looking at plays when I was 18 years old, and I wasn't quite there. I thought the high point for me looking at plays of this type was the work of course, Lorraine Hansberry, which seemed to have a potential for something that did not necessarily show up, but it was pleasing, it was nice to look at. Also turned into a melodrama. But then it's become the most commodified play of the whole, you might say, repertory of African-American work. I mean, Year after year after year, we get these predictions of Raisin in the Sun. We all know Raisin in the Sun by now. And I have to ask myself, suppose somebody would be daring enough to really go deeper into what Lorraine Hansberry had perhaps thought about in her imagining, deep in her imagining. If you look at the play, it is not a play about moving to the suburbs. If you look at the play very seriously, the way it is constructed, the play is about what? The play is about a father who shows up as a trickster figure. He's dead. His form becomes what? Money. He drops himself in the middle of the family, and the family begins to disintegrate. The rest of the play is about how to put the family back together. That is the point we should be looking at. How does a family come back together? By the time we get to the end of the piece, it is not a question of whether they get to go to the suburbs, but are they harmoniously back together? And there are ways, in fact, if you look at the play in terms of an Afrocentric kind of view or African critical response to it, even the moment when the son has his drunken African dance moment, part of a ritual, it becomes a high point in that play, which creates change. After that, everything starts to reveal itself. And that could have been taken much more seriously as a kind of a part of a major ritual exercise to move toward the epiphany of what that work was all about. But we get a time, and of course, we have a new incarnation of it right now with Denzel, pretty boy, nice, cosmetically pleasant. What are we looking at here? Whatever happened to Lorraine Hansberry's play? Well, we can go on all afternoon with that. All right. But the Harlem Renaissance was perhaps the first of the significant groundswell of cultural production by African Americans in art, literature, and music. That particular enterprise largely supported by financial patronage of white Negrophiles produced work that was judged to be excellent facsimiles of the aesthetic conventions of Western canon. That's the trick. If you can prove yourself to be reasonably accepted. We heard something of that in this presentation earlier. The bar was dealing with these questions. You know, what is it? What makes that work black? And is it acceptable? Well, it is not acceptable unless it has again something to do with the narrative that's coming before it. In other words, who is receiving the narrative? And as a result. Black intellectuals of that period also, who were highly crafted and gifted painters and writers, crafted their work in such a way that it would be receptive. I heard that little dialogue with here at the bar. Young woman said, I think it was a young white person said, it's all the same. It is universal, basically. In other words, 18th century notion. We are establishing what is universal. You follow the universal. I'm sorry if I'm going to church with you a little bit. You just forgive me for that little moment. But that happens. So that went on in that particular period. I have then subsequently come to some notion about what is art after all. And I'm going to read this little section to you. If we consider art to be an enlightened, though not necessarily the most elevated sense of reality, then we recognize its capacity to empower the soul. Remember yesterday talking about how one puts one's finger on the soul was very, very important in making of the film. And so we're saying the same thing here, actually. Empowering of the soul. Art, irrespective of the culture that authenticates it, is not merely manufactured craft work. Art is the testament of the human spirit and must be summoned in order to reveal its power to communicate beyond the naturalistic properties of a subject or the subjectivity of personal desire. The larger-than-life scale iconography crafted on the top of Mount Rushmore may be an imposing commemorative monument, but it does not own the spiritual potency of a miniature Congo Nisi doll, which reveals what the Yoruba call ashe. Robert Farris Thompson, the distinguished Africanist art historian, has noted that, quote, art looms large in the Yoruba life and religion, not only because of its implication in the existential process, but also because it generates beauty. And when he says beauty, we're talking about power. The power is where the beauty is. The work of the artist in the creative process is to attract spiritual energy, thus ashe. That which we refer to as art expression, then, is the luminosity of the spirit. The black theater practice we bear witness in black theater practice, or in black art practice for that matter, we bear witness to the fullest manifestation of the flash of the spirit when the performance achieves a poetic, visceral, and phonic manipulation of mundane experience that avoids being trapped in the fixity of time and space. In other words, breaking out of that realism, got to get past that. So as to unleash the beauty revealed to us in its transformative power, and makes you want to throw up both of your hands and holler, what are we going to holler? Ashe. Ashe. Okay. So that to me is where I think art is. And that would be for any art. I mean, that's any art. I've looked at some of the great Vermeer paintings, I can see Ashe. If I look at some of the Rembrandts, certainly. If I look at Mona Lisa, I don't see it. Forgive me. It's not there. But neither is it there in Andy Warhol Campbell's soup cans. I don't see any ashe. I'm not feeling it. There's no sensory response to that. And so for me, that's fabrication. That's some work that people have done. Probably good crafted work, but has no ashe, has no beauty, has no power. So I think that in what I've been trying to do in my trajectory is to, I think you know, there he comes, okay. Let me move it on. I'll move on. What I've done is, when I said that I'm finally getting some traction, is that I'm currently doing a project at Emory University Summer Institute this summer with 25 black scholars on the issue of black aesthetics. We're trying to find a way to get beyond the racialized aspect of that and look more deeply into what makes it African-centered work, whether it's in Brazil, Cuba, United States, wherever it might show up. And the whole idea of that three-week think tank is to start to answer some of the questions the young people were trying to ask in that bar clip. We want to answer some of those questions in this three-week think tank, so that it would not be the end-all, it would be just scratching the surfaces, because we haven't had this exercise before. And I think that my time is there, and I'm going to let this table go, this podium go, and pass it on to my esteemed fellows here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Don't you? I hope that the video is going to start. Paul, that was awesome. Thank you. I am Barbara Chase Riboud, and I'm here because Carrie Mae asked me to be here, and because I have an exhibit now on at the Berkeley Museum, The Malcolm Stells, and a book of my collected and new poems being published in October 2014 by Seven Stories, New York. Every time a knot is undone, a god is released. I'd like to show you the PMA installation, and which moved to Berkeley in another version where it is now. Here are Malcolm's 3, Malcolm 10, Malcolm 11, Malcolm 13, All That Rises Red, Confessions for Myself, 1973, and Tantra, 1994, I Will Let You Roam. The Malcolm Stells began in 1969 and were first shown at MIT's Haydn Galleries and in New York, at the Bertha Schaefer Galleries and the Betty Parson Galleries, which represented me in the 70s. When she died, everyone in her stable found new dealers except the 3 or 4 women that she represented, including Agnes Martin. In the superbly written catalog by Carlos Basualdo, Ellen Handler Spitz, and Gwendolyn Du Bois Shaw, I talk about the literalization of abstraction, which begun with Rauschenberg's Canyon, Jasper Jones's American Flag, and Francis Bacon. Although these Stells are abstract, I did manage to get rid of the legs of my early sculptures, but the aura of persona still persists, although the configurations are completely non-representational. The amazing thing is, these are the drawings from the 60s and the 70s, which accompanied the Stells, and which sort of preceded the monument drawings, which you will see in a minute. Okay, we're now back. The amazing things is the consistency of the Stells over more than 4 decades. There are no early Stells and late Stells. They seem, except for 1 and 4, to have appeared full-blown in 1970. The rest of the exhibit consists of drawings, as I said. People ask me why. Well, why Paris? Why Rome? Besides the fact that I can't fabricate these sculptures in the USA, I have a chance to have a Michelangelo at each end of my street in Rome, and Marie de Medici's palace staring up at me from the Luxembourg Gardens in Paris. Like Man Ray, another Philadelphian who lived down the street from me, I have always rejected the term expatriate. When people asked Man Ray why he lived in Paris, he would always answer in French and with a thick American accent, "I love being an alien." Well, me too. What we found at Berkeley was the same as at the PMA, that it was essential that each Stell have its own place, however ethereal, that to leave them unleashed in a single gallery was to ignite a war of roses, as each Stell fought with the others for space and power. It was amazing, just like real people. I'd like a flashback for a moment to Berkeley in 1973, when I exhibited there, thanks to Peter Sells, the former director of MoMA and Berkeley, who wrote this monologue on me, that I looked alien. In any context, American, European, feminist, female, gay, black, even white abstract male. I was the outsider to beat all outsiders. And actually, of all the reductive labels I've had to fight all my life, alien suits me. Just don't call me an expatriate, please. This exhibit, the 1973 exhibit, according to Seltzer, was only the third major exhibit in a major museum in the USA, the first being by a woman, by an American woman, the first being Georgia O'Keeffe in 1945, the third being Louise Nevelson, and the second just a few months after the Berkeley show. I exhibited there Confessions for Myself and Bathers. And these are other steles, Malcolm steles, from that series, of which there are 13 at the moment, and there will be 20. This is number 9. This is number 12. And this is a related stele, which is Pushkin Untitled, from 1994. And this is Zanzibar Gold, which belongs to the French collection. And it is a 1984 stele. This was the first Malcolm, and this was number 4. And these are the monument drawings as they were shown at the Metropolitan in 1999. I think the critic who most understood my artistic position at that time was one of the writers of the catalog, Françoise Cachan, the celebrated director of the French National Collections. She referred to Darth of Star Wars, Rider, Haggard, Lovecraft, and Borges. Okay, this is Bathers. And as I said, it was Françoise Cachan who really understood for the first time what I was trying to do. And Marcia Tanner's recent review talks about supernatural entities, potent presence, stifled power, armor-plated burkas with problematic robes of complicated knotted strands. Ellen Spitz talks about the inanimate that to the human who and the semblance of self, almost breathable. Judith Stein talks of absorbing light like a black hole, which may mean that I am the forerunner of the new neo-futurists and the African futurists. Bathers morphed into Mao's organ. 2008, which combines futurism with the influence Chinese art had on me after my trip to China in 1965, the first American to officially visit China after the revolution, 3 years before Kissinger and 4 years before Nixon. A later sculpture, Matisse's Back, 1994, was an important part of this metamorphosis. These are the only sculptures that I can make in additions. All my other sculptures are unique pieces. This is Matisse's Back. This Cleopatra series was inspired by the famous 7th century Chinese jade hand shrouds, which had just been unearthed when I was there. The wedding dress, the door, the bed, the chair. And the cape. They are seen against Marc Riboud's landscape photos taken in Hangzhou. This is the current series called the La Musica, begun in the middle of the 2000s. This is La Musica Red, Parkway. La Musica Red number 3. La Musica Red, number 2. La Musica Marion, Parkway. In another view. La Musica Simon Rattle, followed by a series of smaller La Musicas, blue, green, black, alabaster, gold, gold column, and Anne de Asche, homage to the former director of the Philadelphia Museum and the Harnikort. This is Anne H. This is a new series I've just begun, dating from 2009. This is the little gold flag. And this is the little black flag. Finally, I'd like to end with the public sculpture in Lower Manhattan, New York, Africa Rising, 1997. It is listed in the famous Michelin Guide as a monument, although you have probably never heard of it. It is in the lobby of the Federal Building at 290 Broadway, which houses the FBI and sits on the site of the African burial ground under Wall Street, for which the U.S. General Services held a competition of 500 sculptors to mollify the outcry against erecting a building on a graveyard. As a public monument, I wanted a fusion of my own abstract style with a more accessible, naturalistic, minus the sentimentality. And I ended up giving New Yorkers another alien. As I was finishing, here I would like to stop for a moment. If you can just stop on the next image of Africa Rising. No, let's go up to a full image. As I was finishing this monument, and here I have to pause in the movie because I think a disclaimer is in order here. In 1979, I was the author of Sally Hemings, a novel, which walked Sally Hemings through the front door of history, changed my life, changed the history of the United States of America forever. Okay, you can restart the video. As I was finishing this monument, the French government awarded me a knighthood. And just as I received the Carl Sandburg Prize as the best American poet in 1996. This is my Italian family of foundry workers in Milan who produced this 18-foot, 2-ton bronze cast in direct wax, a technique I invented by using wax sheets instead of molded wax, which the workers still call la bestia, the beast. I'll end with this photograph, with this photo of another ongoing series, the shelf poet sculptors. This is the poet walking his door, which is of course a self-portrait, and refers to my other hat as a writer. A portrait by French photographer Jean Lussier. My house in Rome, a 16th century Palazzo Ricci, where at one time the French Cardinal Fesch stored his art collection of 17,000 paintings. Cy Twombly and I have had ateliers on this piazza, him since the 50s, and me since 85. Finally, this is Michelangelo's library bench. We copied from the Farnese Library down the street in the French Embassy. That's my better half up there. And finally, here I am in Mongolia in 65, solitary to the end, with my Han interpreter, my Mongolian interpreter, my official Chinese communist guide just out of the frame, a contemporary artist wandering alone on the steps of a moonscape Mongolia, exploring the myths of centuries and prehistory, neo-futurism, abstraction, science fiction, but always with that otherworldliness mixed with poetic power. And the three P's, my credo being that of Claude Lévi-Strauss, art is the only proof that anything has ever happened in the past.
Hello, I'm Charles Gaines. Yeah, I was waiting for that. I was going to stand here for 10 minutes until I got an applause. My presentation will be fairly brief, mostly because I have to go to the bathroom. What I'm going to do and what I decided to do is to show you an installation called Manifestos, Manifestos 1, that was originally shown in New York 4 years ago, and then shown in Los Angeles at the Hammer Museum. And so the, how do you work this thing? Oh, okay. So this is the installation at the Hammer Museum. Now, generally, I have to preface this to say that my work in general, at least since the mid-90s, has been about conflating things that have no relationship. And this strategy is explained in more detail in an essay I wrote called Metaphor, Metonymy, Art, and the Suppression of Thought, that if you have nothing better to do, you can find on the internet from Art Lies magazine, which generally it talks about the fact that my whole approach to art is to treat it as a way as a means of critical and theoretical speculation. And the speculation is really about the relationship of aesthetics and politics, generally, trying to approach the idea that of the interrelationship of the two, the issue of course, black aesthetics, that is part of the conversation here, is appropriate because it's a subtopic of my own investigation. In the general idea. So, in this piece and manifestos, I've combined music and narrative or language. What I did was I did some research into political manifestos, and I selected four. And you see here four monitors with the titles of the four manifestos that I selected. One, Black Panther, Conscious Changes, which is Guy Debord's manifesto. He's complaining about the state of sociology in France at the time, and Socialist Congress, which is one of the first socialist manifestos written, that was written to tell it's respected to World War I and how the workers of the world were not going to participate in World War I. And I guess they were wrong, but that's the intention of the manifesto, to establish that. And the final one is one of the Zapatista manifestos. So what I did was since manifestos tend to be wordy, I reduced them to about 200 to 300 words. And once I got the text edited down, I applied a system where the letters and words were transcribed into musical notation. So, for example, in the text, the letters A through G were transcribed into musical notes, and I also included the letter H, which was converted to B flat, and particularly because they're using musical notation. And all the other letters of the alphabet were transcribed into rest and silent beats. The music, I wrote it out for piano, and I gave it to a composer who transcribed it for an ensemble, in this case, a five-piece ensemble. I recorded the music in a sound studio, and that recording plays while the text scrolls. So the text of each manifesto scrolls one at a time, from left to right. And then at the end, what you see here is the very last part of that process, where all five manifestos scroll at the same time. You see on the wall there's some drawings. These drawings are blow-ups, or I should say blow-ups. They're scaled up images of the music that I actually wrote and transcribed, so that you can see the letters in between the musical staffs. Each manifesto had produced its own music. What I'm going to show you, I'm going to play the video. It's a 6-minute video. I'm going to play the video of the Black Panther a piece. We see so in here, I just wanted to give you a sort of a closer view so that you will realize that I'm not lying, that I actually did this. So we're panning the drawing from top to bottom. They're pencil drawings. Okay, so if you can keep in mind, while we showed a video, if you can keep in mind that this is a conversation about my interest in the critical and political issues, aspects of aesthetics and affect, we can play the video right now, please. Turn that light off, okay? We need more volume. Thank you. Pizzicato, you heard, was the individual letters of, that are found in the text. The violin was playing those notes, and the chords were chords where it's major and minor chords are built off of the letters, the letter in the particular word. For example, if the first letter in a word was an A, then the chord that accompanies that word that the letter A is in, it would be an A major chord. It has a certain kind of elegiac or sentimental quality because the chord progression is between a major and minor chord. It tends to produce that kind of affect in people. But beyond that, the first time when I wrote this, I didn't know what it was going to sound like until we actually played it in the recording studio. My point being is that I didn't produce this with any aesthetic or interest or intention in terms of how the experience would be received by the viewer. So I tried to remove that my intention, and I used the system of notation in order to do that. This is Manifesto 1. I have Manifestos 2 that was shown by Paula Cooper a few months ago, a little larger piece. And if anybody's interested, it'll be shown at MoMA starting in the middle of June. So thank you very much.
This is what extraordinary work looks like. What extraordinary commitment looks like. When I look at the work of Barbara Chase Riboud, I just feel lazy. The will, the effort, the courage, the strength to make it. Is extraordinary to see and humbles me. This last piece, I am full. You know, very, very quickly, we actually don't have a lot of time. The next panel is going to be starting very soon. Unfortunately, I knew that when I dreamt of inviting these three people, that it really could take the afternoon, that each of them could, we could spend several hours with each of them because they are lives truly lived and lived fully. So I think what we'll do, we have Rick Powell, of course, who is with us. I think we're going to just talk just a little bit about what we have just experienced with these three discussions. And one of the reasons that I mentioned this idea about this generation, that you show me what's possible, that you show me what work is. And Eliza talked about bringing together generations. This is the reason that it's so important to bring the generations to the table together, because we really have so much to not just learn from one another, but to understand through one another's practice. So let's start.
Yes. What a blessing for all of us to be here and engage with Paul Carter Harrison, Barbara Chase Riboud, Charles Gaine, Carrie Mae Weems, et cetera. And I'm so excited that Eliza started us off with that conversation at the Met in 1971 between Sam Gilliam and William T. Williams and Romy Bearden, and to think about that as one bookend And then for Paul and Barbara and Charles and Betty to be the kind of other side of that bookend. And the first thing I want to ask is, I mean, reactions to each other.
Well, I would just say this. I'm astonished by the fact there's no sense of gender in the work of Barbara. There's no sense of gender practice in the work of Barbara, in that particular work I'm looking at, that its monumentality goes way beyond that in itself. And yet, while without any kind of a pre-preparation, or pre-thinking, it seems to also have a very African kind of iconography to me. That's what it appears to be. But the most important thing is that I don't see anything that says this is a black woman doing some work of a black work, and it's actually a monumental piece of work. You have to accept it for where it is. You got to come to it that way. That's my first reaction.
Barbara?
My reaction to
what you see,
Paul and Charles, is simply amazement. You know, I've always admired them both, and I've sort of followed what they were doing. And there was always this idea that these were artists and that they were following their own sort of game without really blackness or race or gender or a lot of other things having anything to do with the essence of what they were doing and how they were doing it. It goes much, and that is really what we're about, to go beyond any kind of labels and to put the stuff out there in the universe and see what happens.
Right.
Without apologies, without explanations, without, affirmative action, none of these things. It's simply out there in the universe. It's universal. Yeah. It's what David Smith said,
Charles?
Yes.
Barbara, when I was a young artist, so many years ago.
don't talk about young artists. Okay.
Barbara's work was one of the first work that I discovered, and because it was already in major books on sculpture, in the late '60s, and I was amazed because there weren't many models out there that a young black artist could follow and think about. And when I heard that she was going to be in this panel, my knees buckled, essentially. And Paul, my God, we had dinner the other night.
Yeah.
And they practically had to kick us out of the restaurant because we had gotten into this really incredible conversation where I was almost as uncanny. It was almost like another version of myself conceptually, that being spoken of in another language, in the language of performance and theater, and mine in the language of art. But some of the views we had about art and over the years in jazz, I mean, we went on and completely analyzed the whole history of jazz. I'm still thrilled by our dinner.
Yeah, it was great evening, great evening.
I have a feeling that there might be a few people that want to ask. We may decide to just take a couple of questions from the audience. If there are any of you that are jumping at the bit to ask a question, we might, maybe we can take two or three from the audience, no more than that. But I am interested. One of the reasons that I wanted to start the day with you, with Sarah, with Eliza, was that I really wanted to sort of set up this tone for thinking about this idea of the power of aesthetic force. And so Paul is working in this way deeply, and of course getting ready to organize his own conference. It's going to happen in July in Atlanta. On the other hand, there is this significant work that Charles has been doing, that you've been doing, around the question of aesthetics and the politics of aesthetics, or the meeting of politics and aesthetics. And then, of course, there's you in the center of this, making the kind of work that you construct. And let's say that even though we are dealing with the complexities of our humanity, we continue to use, for instance, references and historical references that ground the work in an African and a black space, so that we are looking at Malcolm. Right, we're looking at a whole, how many works have you produced around the idea of Malcolm? Extraordinary pieces, right? So even as we talk about the sort of sense of freedom to explore in any way in which we choose, we also choose to work within a very particularized cultural space and to reference that cultural space.
Well, the cultural basis of steles, which are basically architectural memorials to living people, it is something that I applied to Malcolm for that very reason. Probably the most effective influence on my life was a trip I took as a very young girl on a Whitney fellowship to Egypt, where I stayed for 2 months and discovered really who I was and where I come from. And it was natural to me to do this. And actually, this series has been going on for 20 years, more than 20 years.
Okay.
And it seems to have
taken on a life as its own,
and it continues full blown. And you know, it's like my poetry. You know, every time I write a poem, I think this is the last poem I'll ever write, because they come. You know, you grab them, or else they're gone forever. So that's it.
Can the two of you talk about this your ideas around this question of politics and aesthetics? And and I have a sense that you also have differences around what aesthetics might mean. How you're
an issue here is who establishes the groundwork for what is aesthetic, and that's why at this moment we might have to dislodge ourselves from even that term. As African people of African descent who are constructing ideas, you know, be it on plastic or be it music or whatever, because finally, aesthetic is used as a kind of a way of creating a commodification, kind of a marketplace notion, and I think this is why the thing I'm doing this summer is to find a critical vocabulary to be able to talk about what we do. But at this very moment in time, we do not have a critical vocabulary, we African descent, people of African descent. We only have the oblique of postmodernist kind of discourse. And that little chatter does not talk to what we're doing. But yet we find ourselves reaching for it to describe what it is we're doing. And every time I look at a review of something, be it painting or theater or poetry, I said, what are they talking about? That's not what I saw. Mm-hmm. They're talking about something entirely different. So we are hopefully going to find, for the younger people, we saw the bar, a language that they can use to make an evaluation of the product. And plus, for the ideological purposes as well, let alone the sake of commodification. We want to get beyond, you know, how it is being corrupted, our sense of what it is we're doing. Does that make sense? That's what we were talking about the other night.
Yeah, And it does. The first thing, of course, is the considering the idea of an aesthetic. What you're talking about is a type of experience that you have, you know, presumably with the work of art. And the question is, how does that experience? How can experience have agency within this cultural space? Mm-hmm. So this is the debate about how that should happen. And my feeling is, and then I sort of support what you're saying, that we're at a point where we have to develop a critical language around that experience. Mm-hmm. In my own practice, and this is probably where we're, you know, I'm shocked to find out that we might separate in views, is that I found in postmodern critical discourse a certain privileging of language and a certain critique of universalisms and a certain critique of essentialisms that I found useful in order to argue that aesthetics is actually an ideological construction.
I just got to ask this, Charles. I'm sitting there listening to the Black Panther Manifesto. Yes.
Fantastic.
And it just took my breath away. The idea that letters could be connected to sound and space and interval, and that in the process of that, one hears, you know, this amazing plea, agitation, this manifesto, but done not in the way that one assumed one would hear it, you know, a la 1968, but almost as this measured, elegant recitation. We want, we demand, and then take a breath, and then it continues. I mean, just the idea of how systemics can be integrated into a language, and as a result, create not just art, but create an oral plea, is just kind of mind-blowing.
Thank you.
So I am terribly afraid that this panel has gone over time, and that the next panel is already up and ready to roll, and we have to be mindful and respectful of time marching forward. I am so deeply honored to have had you on stage today.
Well, thank you also.
Thank you so much. Thank you.